Hello, everyone. My name is Alexei Tyryshkin. I'm from Princeton University. Thank you for inviting me here and giving this nice opportunity to talk in this auditorium. Although I feel a bit of a stranger here, I don't do magnetic resonance imaging, or I don't do NV centers, anything like that. So what we do is straight electron spin resonance spectroscopy. And I will talk today about our experience of designing a superconducting coplanar waveguide resonator, specifically aiming to do a straight ESR spectroscopy. This work is a collaborative project of two groups, Steve Line from Princeton University and Dave Schuster from University of Chicago. The project started 4 years ago with Dave Schuster visiting our lab, looking for a postdoc position in the group. Unfortunately to him, he ended being hired as a professor to University of Chicago. But since then, we've learned about coplanar waveguide resonators, and we started to do this project. At first, it was Hans Malisa, our postdoc, leading the project. He left 2 years ago, and more later, last 2 years, Anthony Sigilita, our graduate student, was in charge of designing and applying this resonator for electron spin resonance. Let me move along. Here's my outline. I will very briefly introduce you to the purpose of resonators in electron spin resonance spectroscopy, specifically talking about cavity three-dimensional resonators. I will then quickly shift to a small volume two-dimensional resonators, which can be designed based on different structures. Our choice is coplanar waveguide resonator, but you can think of strip lines, lumped element, and anything more, anything complicated, anything you can imagine can be used as structure. Most of the talk is about our experience, pros and cons of superconducting coplanar waveguide resonators. I will talk about flexibility of these resonators. Talk about greatly improved sensitivity as compared to volume resonators. What we wanted most is actually low microwave powers to make it possible to use these resonators in dilution refrigerators temperatures. I will also talk about inhomogeneity of B1 field, which is intrinsic for these two-dimensional structures, which can be an advantage or disadvantage. And I will finish with my conclusions. Electron spin resonance deals with a large ensemble of spins. Typically, it is 10 to 15 spins. They're placed inside the resonator, which I show here as a square. Randomly, these arrows up and down are our spins randomly placed in the resonator. Resonators play a dual role. One is it is used to deliver microwave B1 field to excite our spins. Second is probably more important is to amplify the microwave response from the spins. There are multiple trade-offs you face with when think about resonators. There are many designs which are tuned for one or another purposes, like do you want to have a high homogeneity of B1 field to be able to perfectly control spin orientation and spin rotations? Do you want to have a high spin sensitivity, which is related also to a Q factor? Q factor also of the resonator give you a control over bandwidth of your experiment, but with a payoff in spin sensitivity. Same for microwave power. Resonator is actually a center of a good spectrometer. Having a good resonator is quite important. As I've mentioned, There are many different volume resonators have been designed for different purposes. Here I show one of the typical resonators used in ESR, which is rectangular-shaped TE, producing a mode TE102, with standing mode producing a maximum and homogeneous B1 field in the center of the cavity, and this is where you put your sample in for most homogeneous B1 field and for the strongest response from your spins back to the cavity. For typical dimensions of these resonators have at least two dimensions of the order of lambda, which is wavelength of our microwave frequency. For our typical 10 gigahertz experiment, this means the cavity volume is of the order of 10 centimeters cubed. Sample volume is much smaller since we wanted somewhere in the center in antinode of the magnetic field only, and that's spreading to the rest of the volume. Resonator are designed to have a high homogeneity of B1 field. They're perfectly designed to have a very high tunability. You can tune for high, low Q as you desire. They have disadvantages, at least from our point of view, of doing a small ensemble measurements and at low temperatures. They have large volume. As a result, very small intrinsic spin cavity, individual spin cavity coupling. Each spin has this strong interaction, 0.01 hertz to the cavity. To produce a strong measurable signal, you have to have this many spins to make it possible to measure the signal. Another biggest disadvantage is very large microwave powers requirements. For example, for pulse measurement, you have to use 1 watt to all the way to 1 kilowatt powers to rotate the spin in a desired time. So the bottom line, these resonators, volume resonator, are perfect. They designed and tuned in the last 30 years to do whatever job you want to want them to do. But they are not doing what we wanted to do. So we searched for a solution, and the obvious one was switching to a planar two-dimensional cavities. Here I show a selection of several recent reports. Actually, this field is really booming in the last 5 years. You can find many papers, and here it is very small selection of what is available. You can go very crazy, like this one, fractal coplanar waveguide resonator, where you have an niobium wires going around to form a loop, a bunch of fractal dimension capacitors sticking around. All together, these are forming a resonator with a very strong B1 field here in the center where you place the sample. Another example is, this one is actually from David Corey group, where they used a strip-line structure as a start, but they implemented 4 parallel strip lines together to make it the field homogeneous just above these row of strip lines where they're placing their sample. More standard examples like a loop gap. This is made of copper from Dieter Suter group. This small, it can be called also loop gap, but it is more lumped element with the sample sitting here in this small constriction of 20 micron dimension. We, as I've mentioned before, we followed the step of Dave Schuster, who published the work where they've used a coplanar waveguide structures to measure, in this case, a piece of diamond placed on the top of these fabricated resonators. Okay, briefly through advantages of planar two-dimensional cavities. You can make them very easily with one-step lithography. Like one example is shown here of one of the resonator designs made by Anthony Sigelita. It looks a bit complicated, but in fact it is very simple. We have a transmission feed line going around and a bunch, actually six microwave resonators coupled to this feed line. The coupling of each resonator is defined by this L-shaped segment at the bottom and distance to the feed line, and the length of this L-shaped segment is defining how strong is the coupling. The resonator itself is meandering around. You can make it straight. In this case, to save a space, we just bend it around and making it wiggling around like this. The length of this resonator is about 2 millimeters, starting from this knee and all the way around. At the end, the resonator is terminated by the ground plane such that the length of the resonator along this long dimension is defining the microwave frequency. The volume of this resonator is much smaller. In this particular example, it is 10 to minus 5 centimeter cube. This is six order down from a standard volume resonator. Sample volume is also smaller. Small volume immediately means that we need much lower power, basically six order of magnitude lower power compared to volume resonator to produce a substantial B1 field to rotate our spins in desired time. Also, small volume means much larger spin cavity coupling. Individual spin is now coupled three orders of magnitude stronger to the cavity, 10 to 100 hertz. And we need many more, much fewer spins to get our signal from this resonator. There are also disadvantages of this resonator. One obvious is, and I will stop on this later, is poor homogeneity of B1 field in the resonator. Second is not easy tunability of this resonator. As I mentioned already, a coupling, for example, is defined by this a geometry of the L shape, and there is no simple way of changing it. But this seems to be a very good resonator for low temperatures, which I'm about to show you around. A little more about coplanar waveguide structure. Coplanar waveguide consists of central pin and two ground planes on outside. The width of the pin and the gaps to the ground planes when fabricated with a certain aspect ratio define the impedance of this resonator. In our case, it is 50 ohm. You can use this as a basis and build your resonator by terminating it at the one end, terminating this coplanar waveguide on one end to the ground plate, and on the other end, coupling it to the incoming transmission line. Typical Q factors of this resonator, at least at our temperatures, which is 2K, were of the order of 1 to 10,000 K. You can make them all the way high to 100K or even higher than 200K Q factors if you go colder, which we didn't do yet. I should mention that we had to fabricate it on very thin layers of niobium, 50 to 100 nanometers. And the reason it is this thin is the main reason why we want to have it this thin is to extend the critical field of niobium, which is for bulk of the order of 0.2 Tesla, too small for us. When you go thinner film, you can extend, and in our case, we were able to extend the applied field, magnetic field, all the way to 1 Tesla. One tricky part when dealing with these resonators is you have to apply the magnetic field, DC magnetic field of this order, perfectly in plane of the resonator. If you are slightly off, even by 1 degree, resonator doesn't work. It is catching some fluxes, Q factor goes down, losses goes down, microwave losses going down, and you have to warm up your resonator again, realign it, put it down, cool it down. Later on, we found a nice solution to this problem. We put an LED down below, and whenever we doing realigning, we just shine the LED, which helps to warm it up and release these trap fluxes. And this way, we can realign the resonator properly in plane with magnetic field while keeping it cold. It is a bit tricky, but it is workable, and with some experience, you can do it. You can use these resonators in two different ways. One way is you pattern your resonators on a low-loss sapphire substrate, and then you mount your sample just on top of it. In this case, it is a piece of silicon sample. Or the second option is just patterning it directly on the surface of the silicon sample, in this case, which save you troubles later on mounting, which is not trivial, but okay, it is doable again. In both situations work fine. We were able to demonstrate a comparable sensitivity, comparable power requirements for both arrangements. And down below we show one example for this resonator where we do two pulse echo measurements and then kind of CPMG second refocusing to refocus it to the second echo. And we indeed see two refocused echoes, second echo slightly stronger than the first one. And this is explained by B1 field inhomogeneity. The idea of CPMG is to partially refocus this inhomogeneity, and this is why second pulse is producing a stronger echo. In this case, I show in that case, we were able to get a good signal after 100 averages. Here, we for this resonator, we were able to get for the same sample, but for patterned for resonator patterned directly on the sample, we were able to get to see a signal in a single shot. Let's talk about inhomogeneity of B1 field. This plot show a cross-section at antinode of the strength of magnitude of B1 field above the resonator. So this area is where our sample is. Red bars at the bottom is central pin and ground planes. When we apply the microwave to it, we see B1 being very inhomogeneous. As shown on this contour plot. The distance between these neighboring contour lines is 25%, such that if we have a spin in our sample sitting at this spot and we tune our B1 field to produce a perfect 90-degree rotation for this particular spin, then there is another spin in the ensemble which will be sitting further away and will be rotated by 72 degrees, which is a large error. This is really not a problem for general spectroscopy, which is our focus, but it is certainly unacceptable for precision rotation. Like if you want to do dynamical decoupling or CPMG type of experiments, you want to do you want to have much better control from what this inhomogeneity allow you to in coplanar waveguide resonators. So if you do a Hahn echo experiment using rectangular pulses, you can, and if you tune your B1 field to produce a perfect pi over 2 pi rotations, for example, for spins located in this area, somewhere around this point, for example, in reality, you will be able to see a contribution from spins being here, there, and here as well, but with slightly lower intensity. They will be those pins will be under-rotated, those over-rotated, and only this small slice will be rotated. In any way, in Hahn echo experiment with rectangular pulses, this area is where spins will be contributing two-thirds of our signals. This area can be defined very simple, rule of thumb, the detection, the depth of the spins which are detected in this configuration is approximately one half of the coplanar waveguide widths. Here's another example of the measurement. Actually, it is the same plot from what I've shown before, but now more details. In this case, it was phosphorus donors in silicon 28 epi layer with 10 to 15 per cubic centimeter density. Total number of spins in this area is 10 to 9. Single shot sensitivity, the best single shot sensitivity that we observed was 10 to 7. I would emphasize this is single shot. If you apply averaging, you can easily improve this number to 10 to 5 in a reasonable time, like 10 minutes acquisition. For consistently, I will talk about single shot sensitivity for the rest of the talk. One obvious solution to inhomogeneous problem is using adiabatic pulses to correct for pulse errors. These adiabatic pulses are long known from NMR and surface MRI experiment. We tested several of them, ended using what we call beer-wurst pulse shapes. They look like crazy. Here I plot a real and imaginary pulse of the shape, but they do work perfectly, and they correct the error for a much wider range of B1 fields. We demonstrated it in the volume resonator by applying these pulses. First, we applied rectangular pulses, and we found that spins with B1 fields tuned to be from 30 to approximately 60 microtesla with a ratio of 2 from minimum to the maximum contribute to our signal. However, when using adiabatic pulses, we can extend the range of spins contributing to the signal to much wider, from about factor of 10 from minimum to the maximum. What it means, for rectangular pulses, we are detecting this much of our sample. For adiabatic beer-wurst pulses, we are expanding it to much closer areas to the coplanar waveguide and also to remote areas of the spins. In this particular case, for these pulses, we were able to increase our signal by a factor of 2, this red trace as compared to the blue trace measured with rectangular pulse. At first, it seems strange that it is only a factor of 2 improvement when we increase the area at least by a factor of 4. But the thing is that more distant electrons are coupled less strongly to our resonator, and therefore they are contributing less. So we are extending area of the measured spins much deeper to more remote spins, and they are contributing less altogether combined to another factor of 2 in signal intensity. Okay, when we use Arabi rectangular pulses and try Arabi type of experiments, you detect this kind of curve, which is hardly Arabi. So it goes up, making the first wave of Arabi oscillation, and then it immediately dies, dumping out because of inhomogeneity of B1 field. With Bill-Wurst pulses, we can do it almost perfectly, as it is shown on this plot. We can do arbitrary rotation with very high fidelity. So this, at least partially, adiabatic pulses are solving B1 inhomogeneity problem in these resonators. Inhomogeneity can be actually an advantage. This is kind of a proposal. We didn't try this experiment, but this is obvious extension of what you can do. You can tune your microwave powers to low powers, and then you are sensitive to spins which are approximate to the resonator. You can increase it by a factor of 4, and all of a sudden you are measuring spins which are further away. This is certainly not a nanometer scale like people were talking about in other talks today and yesterday. This is intermediate range of the order of microwave, but the depth and resolution is defined by the dimensions of your coplanar waveguide. You can make it arbitrarily thin, like in this case we were using central line of the order of 35 micron. You can easily go to 1 micron, and this would mean much higher resolution, spatial resolution. It is not a great resolution as such. What is shown here is using a Hahn echo detection. You can improve it further and make it much thinner, much more selective in terms of B1 field by using Karper cell type of sequences. We don't have a dilution we do have now a dilution fridge in our lab. It just came, and we are in the middle of setting it up, hopefully running the experiment using this coplanar waveguide resonators at home. Meantime, we sent Anthony for 10 days to University of Chicago, and he tested the resonator, gave him the first try in dilution fridge at University of Chicago in Dave Schuster laboratory. And here's just two examples of what we've measured: single shot echo measurements without averaging, Hahn echo decay with T2, which is exactly what we expected for this sample. The good news, we don't see any microwave heating, and this tells us that resonator works great, and dilution temperatures as well. So in this particular case, we were using kind of long, 200, 400 nanosecond microwave pulses for pi over 2 pi rotations. Peak microwave pulse powers were of the order of 500 nanometers. And good news, no signal, no sign of microwave heating, which is what we hoped, and it looks like we're on the right route. Another proposal, which we didn't try it yet, so I showed you before this type of structures where we have one feed line for microwave and a bunch of resonators. You can easily make this resonator be in different lengths, meaning different frequencies, and on network analyzer, you can define this frequency very well. These frequencies are totally decoupled from each other, meaning that in principle, you can make one device, a bunch of resonators on them, tuned to the right frequencies that you want to measure, and you can do multi-frequency SR in one experiment using one chip. Another thing we found great about these resonators is using the body of the resonator itself to apply a DC bias to the sample, like it is demonstrated here, applying a bias between central pin and a ground line, with electrical field going away, and also the same inside in the sample. The resonator design that I showed you above, it was impossible because resonators were defined by grounding the central pin to the ground plane permanently at the antinode of the resonator. However, we found a solution by switching from DC termination to a capacitive short, which is shown here. This would require a second layer of photolithography with resonator already being defined, coplanar waveguide already being defined. We grow another layer of ALD on top and plate another layer of niobium to short two ground planes together and form a capacitor between the central pin and the ground plane. The actual resonator used in the experiment I will show on the next slide is shown here. We have two inputs. This capacitive short defining the resonator lengths, and the second input used for tuning, applying a DC voltage to the sample. We've used this resonator to do a Stark effect measurement of donors in silicon. With the electron field not applying, electron wave function is symmetric, and we have one configuration of hyperfine coupling and electronic G factor. When field is applied, everything shifts, electron wave function shifts, coupling constant change, and this leads to change of the electron spin resonance frequencies. This is what we measure it on, as shown on this plot, for two different hyperfine lines of the phosphorus donors and for two different relative orientations of electrical field and magnetic field. Let me finish with my conclusion. So we find this resonator working perfectly. We are very happy with our choice of niobium and coplanar waveguide structures. They can be easily made with one step of photolithography, with many resonators on one chip. Small volume and low micro pulse make them compatible with dilution refrigerators. We were able to show very good sensitivities, absolute number sensitivities. We know how to deal with inhomogeneities of microwave B1 field by using adiabatic pulses. We can partially correct it, or we can think of using inhomogeneity for spatial spin tomography. And we also learn how to do a DC termination, which makes it possible to apply a Bayesian to this type of structures. And it's kind of making it possible to come to even more complicated structures in the future. I will finish at this point. Thank you for your attention.
Somebody started?
Didn't. And we didn't try any other resonator structures. And I think for now we are happy with what we have. We will just keep using it. But yeah, there are other structures, there are other possibilities.
Maybe we can discuss later.
Is there a question over here?
Are there enough surface spins on your coplanar waveguide? You could see the spins in the silicon using this mold. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
There was a yes or no answer question. Right?
Yes, we see spins in silicon. We measure spins in the silicon substrate, or we can put the sample on top of the resonator and measure it this way.
Are there questions? In the back?
Do you see, if you pull down 4 Kelvin to, you know, 100 milli Kelvin, do you see the resonance frequency or the Q factor change?
Q factor is growing up. Resonance frequency changes, but very little. Yes, so what we found in experiment, to tune the field, you cannot scan the field. You need to set it, park it, and keep it there, and realign the sample for this particular magnetic field. And every time you change the field, you need to do it over again. Yeah. Those pulses, we played with them, different durations. The best which worked for us were of the order of 10 microsecond long, much longer compared to typical rectangular pulses we've used. And the length of the pulses is defined by specifics of your spins. Inhomogeneous line widths of your spins. Wider, it's to keep it adiabatic, you need to satisfy several conditions. And to keep pulses adiabatic.
I guess what I'm concerned about, or what I'm wondering about, is, you know, do you get dipolar evolution during the pulse? I mean, do your spins decay? Because they're not necessarily spin locked.
Pulses, okay. I guess this is specific of our donors, our spins. they have very long relaxation time. So we are dealing with, in some samples, this is of the order of 1 second.
So that's a T1 time. T2 is 1 second. Oh, okay. Then you can have a 10 microsecond pulse, no problem.
But yeah, you made a good, very you made a very good point. In a way, by controlling the magnitude of these adiabatic pulses, you drive your spins continuously and you lock them basically. They don't relax at this point, but they will deface because of inhomogeneity of the field, and this is kind of a trade-off. It's not obvious how it goes. We played with several samples. We did the measurement in natural silicon, in the same donors, phosphorus donors, in natural silicon, with much wider inhomogeneous bandwidths and much shorter T2 times. And there we had to readjust parameters of adiabatic pulses to make them shorter and stronger. In order for them to work. So this would be something which you will have to do every time, specific for your spins, to tune them properly to do what you want them to do.
Time for one more question. What limits the
hue
of your resonator, would you say?
For now, it is only temperature. We didn't have a dilution fridge until very recently in our group. And the coldest temperature we were able to go is 2K. And we still see Q is growing up. When switching from 4K to 3K to 2K, it's growing up very quickly.
Let's thank our speakers one more time.